your institute in terms of creating activities on campus, permanent campus. Of course, we've been having a lot of activities in our temporary campus. So, honorable chief guest of the evening, Sri Professor Rajmohan Gandhi, Mrs. Rajmohan Gandhi. The other guests, we have Professor Kapoor, the Pro Vice Chancellor from Swinburne University visiting us, Mrs. Kapoor, and my colleagues from IIT, ICER, then we have guests from other institutions around, dear students. The way we have been setting up this campus, and I'm being a civil engineer and a project manager, the only way we get things done is by setting strong deadlines. Okay, so this part of the quadrangle that we are trying to create for student activities, it was not just getting done. Then I said, the event is going to happen here on so 20 days back when I came here and said, we better get it done. And I'm thankful to our engineering unit staff and the contractors and all of them for getting the place ready. The institute, as all of you know, we've been growing at a reasonable pace. And our main objective, I set myself a target when we started the institute, is the first batch of students should live in the campus at least for 1 year, which we managed to do it. I'm sorry to the girls that we could not make it happen for you. But let's say at least a month, maybe we'll make it happen for you in the last month or so. Having said that, we are evolving the various programs in terms of our academic programs, in terms of our various other activities. But one thing that, when I was a student at IIT Madras in the period 79 to 84 as a BTEC student, one series of lectures that was started by then Director Professor P.V. Indrason, a visionary leader. So his term of the directorship, 5 years, was the 5 years I was a student there. And he said, students are not getting adequate exposure other than their classes, and they need to be aware of current events, what is happening in other domains, whether it's humanities or arts and so on, politics, social issues. So he created this series of lectures called extramural lectures. And as a student, I think this was started in my second year or third year, 81 or 82. I think they started in 82. And I used to make it a point to go for all those lectures. And that lecture series still continues, one of the most popular lecture series on campus, where you bring in really eminent speakers from different walks of life to address the students. So we were discussing this, and Professor Raghuram Raju, I requested him to help in get such a lecture series started. And when we were looking at how to get this started, Professor Raghuram Raju said, I will take the responsibility of getting Professor Gandhi to come and get the lecture series started. So first of all, I would like to thank Professor Rajmohan Gandhi for accepting our request and coming to give the inaugural Distinguished Series lecture series. And the topic that he has chosen is very apt. We have students from about 19 states in our campus here, starting from Kashmir. We have students from Kashmir now, from Arunachal Pradesh, and the rest of the state. But he's going to be talking about the South India, how it figures in the story of India. So very interesting topic. His recent book was launched on this topic. And he's not new to the IIT system. He's a scholar in residence at IIT Gandhinagar. IIT Gandhinagar is another very strong humanities program that's trying to grow. And we're also trying to do a very strong program. So it is very apt that he has, and he's also, of course, Professor Raghuram Raju will introduce him. He's also now teaches at University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. So with, and getting someone who has, strong roots to the formation of this country, both his grandparents were the Gandhiji and Rajaji, both, you know, such eminent figures, being his grandparents, and getting someone like that to come and start our lecture series, I think we're really fortunate. And also, one more thing is, you know, the plants, planting trees, people keep asking me, when are you planting trees? Where are you? How come you're not started planting trees and so on? And I have this enough experience of being from IIT Madras and what I'm seeing in the other IITs. I kept telling people, I don't plant my trees till my master plan is done. Today, in this environmental activism and so on, once I plant a tree, I cannot remove it. And you're constrained. So 50 years down the line, the then director and the administration will be cursing me for planting trees in a haphazard way. So we have sort of held it off. Now that the master plan is done, we have started. So I had our horticultural specialist here over the weekend said, which is the place I should start planting the tree? So they said, this is the place I should plant the tree. So we had, again, the honor of Professor Gandhi coming and doing the first tree plantation in our campus. Thank you very much, sir, for accepting your answer. So with that, I would like to request Professor Raghuram Raju to introduce today's speaker. Professor Raghuram Raju.
Thank you very much. On behalf of our director and all others of IIT Tirupati, I deem it a great privilege to introduce today's speaker, who is giving us the first lecture in this IIT Tirupati Distinguished Lecture Series. Professor Rajmohan Gandhi is a biographer and a research professor at the Center for South Asia and Middle East Studies, University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. He is the grandson of Mahatma Gandhi and Chakravarti Rajagopalachari. And an important aspect of this combination is that both of them are not only politicians par excellence, but also excellent writers and authors. And that combination is very rare and very unique. And Professor Rajmohan Gandhi and his two brothers, Professor Ramchandra Gandhi and Professor Gopal Krishna Gandhi, inherit that streak, which is very, very important. He is also a scholar in residence at Indian Institute of Technology, Gandhinagar. He has been engaging in trust building, reconciliation, and promotion of democracy in this country. This is important for two important reasons: that in IIT Tirupati, we're all preoccupied in discharging two important duties. One is doing our own work as teachers, as students, as staff, as faculty members. At the same time, we are also making the foundations for setting trends for building this new institution. Professor Rajmohan Gandhi's writing canvas captures, in addition to these two, a third one, namely that he's researched on the pre-independent India and the problems associated with pre-independent India, and then how the national leaders have embarked on not only doing their work as politicians, as governments, but also laying the foundation for this new nation called India. So that is a very complex terrain, and nobody other than Rajmohan Gandhiji discharged these things in his writings very meticulously, in a very balanced and also in a comprehensive way. The writings encompass the biography of Ghaffar Khan, nonviolent Badshah of the Pakhtuns. And then he does something very, very interesting and slightly, you know, very intriguing, namely, he has a book called Mohandas. We all know Gandhiji as a Mahatma, but he brings out the non-Mahatma ordinariness, so that he does something fantastic in this book. And then there are two other books that actually made me cry. One is his biography of Patel, and if you read that book, you will really know what is the relation between Patel and Gandhi that we don't generally come to know. And this book is heavily researched. I, as a researcher in academics, feel a bit ashamed that I am not able to do that much of research in bringing out the nuances. And then his biography of Rajaji, it is not that easy to write. The grandson writing the biographies of the grandfather is not that easy. And then Professor Rajmohan Gandhi discharges this and embarks on this project in a majestic and a very, very productive way. And then he has another two important aspects. He embarks on writing on Punjab, which is the one of the important areas of turmoil, and also now modern South India, which is again looks at the canvas if you are really picking up what you are trying to traverse. He is also a politician, and I will not speak more on that, but he is also a journalist, which I think is inherited from his father immediately. He was the editor in charge of Indian Express in Madras, and also a founding editor of a very important journal called Himmat. In addition to that, in 1960s, he played a leading role in establishing Asian Plateau at Panchgani, which is a conference center for initiatives of change in the mountain. The place is located in the mountains of Western India. So, with this brief introduction, I also want to add something very, very important. We are also fortunate to have Mrs. Usha Gandhiji in our midst, and she is the person who introduced us to Kalankari art from Kalahasti. We didn't know about this, and when Professor Rajmohan Gandhi and Mrs. Usha Gandhi came last time to Tirupati to Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, she insisted that she goes and meets this artist, and then we have to, you know, we had no choice but accompany her, and that actually has been a very productive interaction in dealing with the immediate which is around us. So with this introduction, I now request Professor Rajmohan Gandhi to deliver the first IIT Tirupati Distinguished Lecture Series. Professor Rajmohan.
Well, this is a very great honor for me. Director Satyanarayana, Professor Raghuram Raju, all the other professors, family members, visitors, students, to have planted this tree here, the first tree, the Bogoda tree here, is a very great honor for me. And I'm only hoping that when 30, 40, 50, 60 years from now, I have only one grandchild now, but maybe there'll be more then. If my grandchildren or great-grandchildren come here and find that tree, it'll be a very great thing for me. So I thank you for that honor. Now, as Professor Raghuram Raju has mentioned, I am a biographer. I've written many biographies. If it were up to me, I would much rather discover from all of you your biographies. I would like to really love to know about each of you, because you've come from different parts of this country, perhaps some maybe even from other parts of the world, or maybe not, but wherever you've come from, there are great stories in your lives. And what would mean the most to me, it may not happen this time, is to discover something about you. That is ideally what I would love to do. But today I'm going to speak to you about South India's role in India's story. And this is, of course, connected to my latest book, Modern South India, A History from the 17th Century to Our Times. Now, you are aware that when a mother or a father has a newborn child, they always talk about the newborn child. And an author who has written a new book loves to talk about his or her latest child. So I'm very happy to speak about this book, and my lecture is connected to this. I would like to mention how this book came about. Yes, my mother is a South Indian. She is no longer living. She was a Tamil-speaking person. She was Rajaji's daughter. I've spent a fair amount of time in Chennai, some other parts of South India. But there was another reason for my doing this book. Of course, South India is not a region the history of which is known to everybody. Certainly in the rest of India, South India is understood in a very limited way. Yes, South Indian food is well known, and you have seen signs across the country about South Indian food is available, South Indian food, Chinese food, and so forth. But the story of South India is not really known in the rest of the country or in the rest of the world. Another reason for my attempting this was is as follows. Professor Raghuram Raju mentioned my history of Punjab. The history of Punjab I wrote is not the history of Indian Punjab, which is a small part of the Punjabi-speaking world. The Punjab that I wrote about was the undivided Punjab that existed before the British left India. Some of you should see it on maps. It was a large entity. Much of Pakistani Punjab was part of it. India's Punjab, India's Haryana, India's Himachal Pradesh was part of it. At one stage, even Kashmir and parts of Afghanistan were part of once a large area called Punjab. And the reason why I wrote that book was something like this. In 1947 came independence, also came partition, also came tragic killings. And most of these killings, the bulk of these killings were took place in Punjab, in Pakistani Punjab and in Indian Punjab. And I wanted to figure out why those killings had taken place. I wanted to know not just the immediate history preceding 47, but also a longer term history, because I wanted to understand the deeper roots of the killings that took place in 47, those very tragic killings, great carnage. So I did a history from Aurangzeb to Mountbatten. Now some of you may know that Aurangzeb was the very last big Mughal emperor. He died in the year 1707. Mountbatten, under him, India was partitioned in 1947. So I have written a 240-year history of Punjab. Now, during these 240 years, many controversial events took place in Punjab, culminating in the partition of 47. 240 years is a long time. And till today, many people have very strong opinions about many of these great incidents. Several Hindus have their versions. Several Muslims have their versions. Several Sikhs have their versions. The British have their versions. So when I wrote my history of Punjab 240 years, I was absolutely sure that many people would attack me. This is not fair. This is not accurate. This is not complete. I expected criticism like that from several quarters. Mercifully and surprisingly, it was a pleasant surprise to me, there was general acceptance that, yes, this Punjab history is reasonably impartially, reasonably objectively written, and I was greatly relieved by that. And when that happened, I found the courage to embark on a history of this very large area called South India. Now, this my South India here is all of India that is south of Orissa and south of Maharashtra. So the Telugu-speaking world, the Kannada-speaking world, Malayalam-speaking world, Konkani-speaking world, Tulu-speaking world, Tamil-speaking world, and of course, there are many other languages spoken by many tribes that live in southern India. Now, I haven't covered every single story here. It's only 500 pages, but I've tried to give a broad history for over 400 years of South India. Now, some people might, of course, ask, is there something called South India? Is it only a combination of two words? Is there any real entity called South India? Well, 101 years ago, there was a professor of history and archaeology at Madras University, and he wrote of, quote, South India, a distinct entity in Indian history. Now, in more recent decades, of course, many people have written histories of the Telugu world, the Kannada world, the Malayali world, the Tamil world, the other cultures in the region, but nobody in recent years has attempted an integrated story of South India as a whole. So that is what I've tried to attempt. There's one obvious difference, physical difference between North India and South India, that any of you, if you think about it for 1 second, you will come to that difference. A very plain, obvious difference between North India and South India. North India is influenced by the Himalayas. South India is influenced by the oceans. And because South India has had the oceans on both sides, on the Coromandel coast, the east coast, the Arabian Sea and the west coast, this has meant that South India has always had trade with the rest of the world. You are aware of the earlier empires, kingdoms in Southern India that traded with and had all kinds of relations with Southeast Asia, Eastern Asia, Middle East, Africa, even with the Roman Empire. And there are ancient records from Rome and from China about South Indian kingdoms, South Indian ports, South Indian trade. Now, in earlier centuries, I'm now talking about 16th, 17th, 18th centuries, about around the time the Europeans came to South India, there was trade between Indian ports, and overseas ports. But there weren't many roads within India. And because trade was large and roads were scarce, there were many ports along the eastern coast and along the western coast. And the ports were close to one another. And some of you may be familiar with the fact that in the 13th century, the Kakatiya king Ganapati had this inscription in a place called Motupalli, today a coastal village in Prakasham district. At that time, it was a leading port. And this is what the king had inscribed in this village or in this port, that His Majesty, the King Ganapati Deva, guarantees to all traders who go to all continents, countries and towns, that in the past, kings seized all the cargo. They seized gold, they seized elephants, they seized horses, jewels. And when sea-going vessels were caught in storms, they were wrecked and they were cast on shore and, of course, enabled people also to steal what they contained. But the king goes on to say, King Ganapati, we, for the sake of our reputation and religious merit, out of pity for those who have incurred the grave risk of a sea voyage, and thinking that wealth is more valuable even than life, we give up all but the customary tariff. So he says there will be virtually free trade. A very interesting picture of life in coastal Andhra at that time. Now, another thing that must have occurred to many of you, if you look back at India's history, there have been many invasions north to south. Can you think of many invasions south to north? Which South Indian king or South Indian kingdom invaded the northern part of India? Interesting question to ask. Was there any major southern kingdom in the 17th century, 18th century, 19th century that could proceed, that had the capacity, the resources, as well as the desire, the urge to move to the north and capture the north? Now, some of you know something that happened in 1565. Who knows what happened in the year 1565? Put up your hands. A great battle took place in 1565. Talikota, yes. Who said that from there? Very good. There are some very learned people here. So, that was the defeat of the Vijayanagara kingdom at the hands of the various sultanates of the Bahmani kingdom who combined together. 1565, that was a very important event when the Vijayanagara kingdom more or less ended itself. Now, 20, 30 years after this, maybe 35 years after this, early in the 17th century, 1600 something, there was a very big war in southern India, further south of here, in Tanjavur. And there was a Portuguese visitor there, a Jesuit priest, Manuel Baradas. He spoke of Tanjavur, shade-giving trees, strong walls, a moat, Then he said there was a war in the Trichy region, Trichy in the Tamil area, in the year 1616, which according to this Portuguese visitor was fought by as many as 1 million soldiers. Imagine, 1 million soldiers fighting a war in the year 1617. That must have killed so many people and of course destroyed so much wealth and so much food. I mention this to give you an idea that in the 16th, 17th century, before the Europeans established themselves, southern India was not a united place. It was fighting with each other. There were various kingdoms, some small, some large, fighting with each other, and it was not a united place. In 1639, the English East India Company started Fort St. George on a strip of land which they obtained from the Raja of Chandragiri, near here. So the East India Company sent their Indian Dubashis, their Indian allies, to the Raja of Chandragiri, obtained this piece of land, which then became Fort St. George. It became really Madras City. So your area, this amazing area with these wonderful hills around you, is where really the East India Company started. So the European advent, European control over South India is very much connected to where you are. So it's not bad for you to understand a bit of this history. But the other thing to realize is this. The British were not the only people who were here in the early 17th century. The Portuguese were already here. The Dutch came before the British. Portuguese first, Dutch second, British third, the French last. These are four powers that were trying to control South India in the 17th century. And they were trying to establish themselves, establishing warehouses, godowns, where their ships could come, bring their goods, sell their goods, where goods to be brought from India were also stored, and the ships then were filled with these Indian goods, and then they went away. And along with the warehouses or godowns, they also then had soldiers and they had businessmen. So there were pockets established, different points on the coast, both the eastern coast and the west coast of southern India. But to arrange these bases, these centers for European trade, they had to negotiate with Indian princes, Indian Nawabs or Indian rulers, Indian Rajas. I mentioned that the East India Company got the land from the Raja of Chandragiri. But in the next 30, 40 years, these European companies had to negotiate with several rulers because the rulers kept changing. There was the Sultan of Golconda, now called Hyderabad. And he had control over the Sarkars and even over this part of southern India. And so his permission had to be taken. But then in the 1670s, 1680s, Aurangzeb, the last great Mughal, came here, defeated the Sultan of Golconda, defeated other southern Indian chiefs. And so Aurangzeb became the ruler and permission had to be obtained from him or from his son. There was a prince called Kambaksh, his son. And then the Marathas were also here. Some of you know that the Marathas went and established a kingdom in Tanjavur in 1670s and thereafter. So the very fact that the Europeans had to deal with so many rulers also gives you an indication of how unstable South India was, how there was no united rule in South India at that time. In 1724, something interesting happened. So this is after Aurangzeb has captured much of the south, and in Hyderabad, formerly known as Golconda, then renamed Hyderabad, Aurangzeb established a viceroy. And that viceroy was supposed to be looking after the south for Aurangzeb. But this ruler in 1724, he rebelled. He became autonomous. He threw off his connection with Aurangzeb or with the Mughals. And that is how the latest Asif Jahi kingdom of Hyderabad started. But although he was a ruler of Hyderabad, he was not really the ruler of all of South India. And there were so many other rulers in different parts of Southern India. Now, how many here, by the way, understand the Telugu language? Don't be shy, put up your hands. How many understand the Telugu language? Wonderful. Okay, thank you. How many of you who understand the Telugu language have heard of the Bobili War? Just a handful of you. This was an amazing war in the 1750s. So this is, and there are three remarkable authors, and I've consulted them a lot for my research. There's a man from Andhra called Velchiru Narayan Rao. There's a Tamil historian now living in America. Narayan Rao also lives in America, called Sanjay Subramaniam. And there's an amazing scholar who's actually an Israeli. His name is David Shulman. He speaks Telugu, he speaks Tamil, he speaks Arabic. He's an incredible historian of southern India too. And he fights for justice and reconciliation in Palestine. He's just an incredible man. But Shulman, Narayan Rao, and Sanjay Subramaniam together have written a few amazing books about southern India. And they have written a very great account of this Bobili War, which took place in the 1750s. And why is it significant? Now, 1750s is really before any European power has conquered all of South India. Yes, there were outposts established on both coasts. But then there was a French man called Bussy, B-U-S-S-Y. Some of you may have heard of him. Well-known French man who had much to do with the Telugu country, Hyderabad. So he decided that the French would establish control over the Sarkars, and he would wanted to collect, to be sure that not only would now the Europeans trade between India and the rest of the world, the Europeans would control the land and they would collect tax from the land. Europeans would control tax from the land. Instead of the Indian Rajas, rulers collecting tax, Europeans would control, collect the tax. So Bussy came and he went to Vizianagaram, and then Bobili is further north of Vizianagaram, and he wanted to enlist Vizianagaram to attack Bobili. And that is a very famous war. These were neighboring kingdoms, and possibly there was some relationship. They were from similar castes also, the rulers of Vizianagaram and Bobili. But when the war took place between these two, and the Frenchman Bussy supporting Vizianagaram, or Vizianagaram supporting Bussy, it caused a very great consternation in the Bobili kingdom. Because at that time, the idea was that these French, these Europeans, they were polluted people. They ate all kinds of strange food. They had strange habits. They were coming to destroy our culture. And if we allow them to come and take over, everything that we love will be destroyed. And so if the French come and they attack us and they defeat us, we'll become corrupt, we'll become polluted. Far better, therefore, to kill ourselves. That was the deep conviction. And great poems and ballads have been written about that. And these have been presented in this book. And I mentioned this, of course the story is worth reading, it's also briefly mentioned in my book. I won't give you the details of it. But the thing to understand from this is that in 1750s, when the French, and this was happening elsewhere too, where the British were moving into the hinterland of southern India, the Indian rulers were divided. Bobili and Vizianagaram were fighting each other like energy. Deep enmity. And all right, they were, both of them were against the French, both of them were against the Europeans, both of them were against foreign culture, but they fought each other, and the French, of course, prevailed. At times, some wisdom was also expressed, and the Bobili ruler, Vengaraya, he made a last-minute attempt for peace, but Vizianagaram did not agree. And he said something like this to his own people who were agitating him or inciting him to fight and to kill the Vizianagaram army. If we defeat Bussy and if we defeat Vijayaram Raju today, tomorrow the Nizam will come. After the Nizam, the Delhi army may arrive, or the Maratha cavalry will come and destroy our country. We cannot win by the sword. But that that plea of his was not accepted, and there was a war, and the Bobili rulers, they killed themselves, because to them an honorable suicide was preferable to humiliating defeat. So South India's native chiefs saw one another as the enemy and the British East India Company or the French as allies. This is the simple story of how South India became part of the British Empire. Now, we can go a little forward, and in the 1790s something happened in South India, a little further south of here. Who knows what happened in 1799? Something big happened in 1799. 1799. Any hands going up? Have you heard of Tipu Sultan? Tipu Sultan was the ruler of what was called Mysore, and it was a very large area. And before Tipu, it was his father, Haider Ali. So Haider Ali and Tipu Sultan ruled what was called Mysore for 38 years. And they were not perfect rulers. In fact, they had some very serious weaknesses. But they gave Mysore stability for 38 years, and the economy improved, and various things happened. In fact, they were such, and their armies, which contained people of all kinds, their officers, their administrators, most of them were Brahmins in Mysore, the administrators for Haider Ali and Tipu. They were very strong. There was Tipu in Mysore. There was the Nizam in Hyderabad. There were the Marathas in Pune. There was somebody called the Nawab of Arcot in the Tamil area, who was earlier a representative of the Mughals, but he'd become independent, become a ruler of the Tamil part of southern India. And then there were the Hindu Maharajas of Travancore, who were also quite strong. Rama Varma, Balarama Varma, and original was Martand Varma. So there was the Hindu kingdom of Travancore. There was Haider Ali and Tipu in Mysore. There was Nizam in Hyderabad. There was Marathas in Pune. But nobody suggested that these people should have talks with each other, should come together and prevent the Europeans from taking over southern India. That is the hard story. Because these Indian kingdoms in southern India were not willing to negotiate with one another, it made it easy for the Europeans to come and capture power. Now, Tipu's death in 1799 is a very important... By the way, the British were so impressed by Tipu's strength and fighting abilities, because earlier he had defeated the British in some very major battles. Who else in the world around that time was a very big enemy of the British? Who knows? In the late 1790s, early 1810s, the British had a very big enemy in Europe. Napoleon. And Tipu tried to make an alliance with Napoleon. He failed. But it's important to know that the British, at that time, the British media, the British artists, the British poets, the British novelists all wrote about these two very great enemies of the British, Napoleon in Europe and Tipu in southern India. When Tipu was defeated in 1799, he was killed. Thereafter, for the next 10 years, there were several rebellions in southern India, in the Tamil country, in the Malayalam country, and I don't know at that time how many rebellions there were in the Telugu country, but certainly there were many in Kerala and in Tamil Nadu and in Vellore. But those rebellions were crushed within 10 years. And by 1810, the British conquest of southern India was absolutely sealed, and it became then a lasting thing. And the obvious lesson: if they wish to succeed, foes of domination, foes of intimidation must learn to come together and stay together. Now, I mentioned earlier how many Southerners had the idea even of moving to the north and ruling from the north, or capturing portions of the north, not many. Then in the independence struggle, there were many very interesting South Indian figures, some great South Indian figures, and they're also, I have attempted to capture their story in my study. And one of them was actually my mother's father, Rajaji. He died in 1972 at the age of 94. He became a very close colleague of Gandhi. When Gandhi was in South Africa, Rajaji was a very young lawyer in southern India, in Salem. He heard about what Gandhi was doing in South Africa and his being willing to go to jail, the willingness of his wife to go to jail, and many other Indians in South Africa willing to go to jail to fight for the rights of the Indians there. So Rajaji sent a fair amount of money to Gandhi for his campaign in South Africa at a very young age. So when Gandhi came to India in 1915, Rajaji said, well, this man's approach, Satyagraha, may well succeed in India. He became one of Gandhi's earliest colleagues. And then, after being many times himself in prison, in 48, Rajaji became India's Governor General, the head of India. Who was the last Indian head of India? Before Rajaji, the last Indian head of India was Bahadur Shah Zafar, the Mughal Emperor, who the British had arrested and sent to Burma. Not to Burma, not to Andaman, but close, yes. So Rajaji became Governor General of India. However, and he also was once Home Minister of India. Of course, he was Chief Minister, Prime Minister of Madras Presidency. But Rajaji was reluctant to try and become the leader of India. He was very happy to support Gandhi, very happy to support Jawaharlal Nehru, very happy to support Vallabhai Patel, but reluctant to become to say, I am going to lead all of India. He was reluctant to say that. Then there was another very interesting Tamil leader that you know of who came very close to all India leadership. Can you think of him? Kamraj. Kamraj became Congress president. He was the Congress president when Nehru died. And he had a role in installing Lal Bahadur Shastri as prime minister. He was the Congress president when Shastri died. He had a role in establishing Indira Gandhi as Shastri's successor. So he was the king maker, but not the king. He was reluctant to be the king. Of course, many years thereafter, somebody from Andhra became Prime Minister of India, P.V. Narasimha Rao. And some years after that, somebody from Karnataka became Prime Minister, Devegowda. But I think we can say that neither Rajaji, nor Kamaraj, nor Narasimha Rao, nor Devegowda really said, I will take charge of India. They were willing to play a great part. They took great risks. They showed great abilities. But the desire, the thirst, the hunger to lead all of India, to carry all of India to a new path, to help India give a message to the whole world, those bold goals were not really embraced by even these remarkable persons. They were very powerful southern ministers in Delhi. Can you think of some very powerful ministers from South India in Delhi government? Krishna Menon from Kerala, T.T. Krishnamachari, C. Subramaniam, others also you can think of. And of course, there have been 6 South Indian presidents of India. Dr. Radhakrishnan, first. V.V. Giri. Then Neelam Sanjeev Reddy, then R. Venkat Raman, K. R. Narayanan, and A. P. J. Abdul Kalam. 6 amazing, very impressive presidents of India. So South India has had opportunities. But the question to ask is, how many in the South had the urge, the passion? And there's one very big question that that must be obvious to you. So can you think of one big reason why neither Rajaji nor Kamaraj, nor any other big South, nor Radhakrishnan, nor any other South Indian leader quite had the chance to become the leader of India as a whole by themselves. One big reason.
Couldn't speak Hindi.
Absolutely right. Either couldn't speak Hindi or didn't want to speak Hindi. So the unwillingness to say, all right, I will learn Hindi so that I can help to lead India. So this was a very major weakness. So you can think about that when you think of India's role in the story of India. Now there are a couple of other things that I must mention before I invite some questions. From the south, for centuries, a very interesting idea has emerged. Not always very clearly expressed, but a very important idea, a radical idea, a modern idea, but it's been there for centuries. And this is the idea of equality. Now you know, all of you know that India has for centuries has had this notion of hierarchy, caste system. That some people are high, some people are low. Within a family, some people are high, husband is high, father is high, others are low. Hierarchy, hierarchy, hierarchy. This unfortunate hierarchy has existed in India for centuries, but especially in the southern part of India, for a very long time there has been the notion that there should be equality. Yes, we don't practice equalities, but equality is necessary. And some very great thinkers in the South have presented this. And there is this old Tamil thing, Yadamuru Yavaram Kelir. All towns are one to us, all people are kin. All towns are the same to us, all the people are our relatives. What a radical notion. And you know, when in the 1890s, or 1880s, 1890s, some amazing ancient Tamil books were discovered. They were there earlier, they had been forgotten. So some of them had been written by Jains and Buddhists. And these were great stories. And they were stories, yes, they were stories about kingdoms and empires. But the stories spoke about ordinary people. And the towns where the stories unfolded were sophisticated. They held people of different religions. And ordinary people were the heroes of these stories. So it was a remarkable thing. It was anticipating the rise of the common person. So this is now the Telugu world produced a remarkable poet and playwright called Gurjad Apparao. You know about him. You know his book Kanyashulkam, Bride Price, or Girls for Sale, sometimes you call it. But Gurjad Apparao has this line. It's not from Kanyashulkam, but from elsewhere. And this is the English translation by the well-known poet Sri Sri. And this is the English translation. Please listen carefully. Never does land mean clay and sand. The people, they are the land. Clay and sand is not the country. The people are the country. Hills are beautiful, rivers are beautiful, but the people are the country. It is a tremendous notion. And so the notion of equality, the notion of the people as being the country, is a very powerful thought that the South has entertained, sometimes expressed, and it is something that all of India very greatly needs, I would say all the world very greatly needs. So when in 1956 the maps were made, new maps, Telugu province was created, Andhra Pradesh, and then Karnataka was created, Kerala was created, Madras Presidency was broken up. The idea at that point was not that Tamil and Telugus and Kannadas and Malayalis will fight with each other. No! The idea was that people will speak in their own language to the government. Government will become easier. Governance will become easier. Life will become easier for the common person. The idea was not that neighboring linguistic groups will fight with one another. it was a wonderful notion of linguistic, and of course not very far from here, Nellore was Sri Ramanu's place. Madras also was his place, but Nellore was very much his place. And his sacrifice helped create Andhra. And when Periyar spoke of Dravida Nadu, yes, that had, to many people, it had some distasteful aspects. Why should Dravida Nadu become separate from India? Many people didn't like that. And many people in Andhra and Karnataka and in Kerala thought that Dravida Nadu was an idea for the Tamil people to dominate all of South India. But if you leave that aside, if you leave aside the, you might say, some not so pleasant aspects of Dravida Nadu, in Periyar's philosophy also there was a lot of equality, a lot of compassion, and especially women's rights. And many people don't know. People think that the non-Brahmin movement was only a Tamil movement, but it was very strong even in the Telugu area. Many of you are aware that it was quite strong in Telugu area and in Karnataka and in Kerala also, a little less in Kerala, but very much in Andhra, Karnataka. So the idea of compassion, of equality, has a very strong basis in southern India. And I must also tell you this, that many Europeans who were, and this is in my book, many Europeans who were here in the 18th century, 19th century, said that so many South Indians they met knew three or four languages. The poet Vemana from the Telugu area, this French man, Abbey Du Bois, found translations of Vemana in Malayalam, in Kannada, in Tamil. So Vemana's poetry was known all across southern India. There were many South Indians who knew more than one language. Now this area where you are, Chittoor district, is an amazing area where not only is Telugu spoken, but sometimes Tamil is spoken, Kannada is spoken. So such areas are very precious. Chennai used to be the hub of Telugu literature. That's no longer the case. It's very sad. But I think if we remember that linguistic separateness does not mean enmity, it can only mean an increase in diversity and in cultural richness. So I think I will stop with this. I'm grateful to you for listening to me, and I hope if you will allow, maybe there could be a few questions. Sorry? Yes. Thank you very much for listening patiently to me.
Dealing with missions, we have forgotten men and women, what they have done for our country. Thanks a lot for young students here. Now I think we will have some questions. It's not a classroom. You can ask as many questions as possible. So I think we will start with the first question.
No, let's start with the young students.
Yeah, you can talk. You can start with him.
Contrary to the popular Aryan migration theory, people from South India migrated about 60,000 years ago to the north and to the Eurasian continent. So what are your views about this theory based on genetic evidence?
Okay. 17th century to our times. You're asking about few thousand years ago. So I plead ignorance. I cannot answer. Thank you. Very important question, but I have no knowledge on that. Forgive me.
Literary works that happened during Vijayanagara Empire.
Yes.
There are Ashtadiggajas, that means eight yes. poets.
Yes.
Including Kanal Ramakrishna.
Yes.
Ninth poet.
Yes.
Is there some thing about that?
So even there, you see, 1565, Krishnadevadatta, my story starts from the 17th century. So please ask me questions about 17th century, 18th century, 19th century, 20th century, first 18 years of 21st century, but before that, no.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening. Good evening, sir.
Yeah. Good evening.
You were mentioning the era where...
Yes.
But what was the factor which unified all of these kingdoms during the fight for the independence? Like in North, Gandhiji was pretty influential for unifying the Northern India. What was the wholesome factor which unified these Southern kingdoms to take part in the independence? Because it was earlier mentioned that they were fighting each other. So there must be some component which might have unified these things.
So why do you think Gandhi was not influential in South India?
Yeah, he was, as it was mentioned, that the reluctance to speak Hindi, all those factors, considering all those factors, like who were the leaders who took the notion of Gandhiji to the South?
Not just the notion of Gandhiji. Gandhiji was, by the way, sit down, please sit down. Thank you for a very good question. First of all, I want to clarify that my purpose in writing this history is not to discover who were the good men and who were the bad men. Who were the guilty and who were the innocent? Who was greater, who was less great? No. My purpose in studying history is to recall earlier times, to recreate 17th century, 18th century, 19th century, 20th century, and then let us see what happened at that time. So, when I say that Mahatma Gandhi was perhaps the most outstanding leader of the freedom movement for the whole country, that is not to compare others with him and say that they were less great or less important. But there is absolutely no doubt that Mahatma Gandhi was also very much loved all across South India, and if I may say so, particularly in the Telugu part of is that correct?
Yes.
I mean, I was in Vijayawada and in Guntur, and there is absolutely no doubt that the spirit of unity, dedication, commitment, sacrifice, equality, all that important ingredients of the freedom movement were much loved, especially in the Telugu area and all across South also. And there were many other outstanding leaders. Many other absolutely, and even before Gandhiji, there were great leaders who inspired the Swaraj movement in South India. Many from Bengal came here and also encouraged. So, South India has its own galaxy of amazing freedom fighters. But it is true that Hindi was a kind of a stumbling block. It is true that although Telugu, Kannada, even Tamil, Malayalam have many Sanskrit words, have many words that people in North may also understand, the roots of the southern languages are in the Dravidian language. And so, Hindi was not naturally accessible, easy for South Indians at that time. Of course, now so many other things have happened, people move around and Hindi is becoming more popular. But very, very few leaders from... P.V. Narasimha Rao was an exception, he spoke Hindi very well. But he was never the kind of mass leader that others were. So, Hindi was a very large factor that came in the way. But I think it is fair to say that if any of you say, all right, we want to have a say in shaping the future of India, I will do whatever is necessary to do that. If necessary, I will learn Hindi. I want to have a say in the whole world story. If necessary, I will learn Chinese. So that is what leadership requires. And so the question really, it's not, I don't have an answer to that question. I found that in my study of South Indian history, again and again, I found many absolutely outstanding South Indians who made an impact in all of India, but I did not find a hunger, a passion in South Indians. We will take charge of India as a whole.
Except Tipu Sultan or Nizam of Hyderabad.
Absolutely amazing figures. But after Nizam and Tipu and in more recent years, by the way, Anyway, I don't want to take the names, but absolutely amazing names all across South India were in the freedom movement. And coming to more recent times, have you heard of T. Prakasham? Tanguturi Prakasham?
I think you're not from Andhra, right? Yeah, Tanguturi Prakasham.
No, you're not, but you must hear of, learn about him. Incredible person. What sacrifice, what courage. And there were so many others. In every town and village in South India, they were local heroes or state-wise heroes. People capable of being national heroes. So it is true that the rest of India does not know enough about the dedicated, brave freedom fight led by so many people here.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, here.
He was writing about Napoleon and Tipu in a very glorifying account. Now when we see other sorts of imperial history, especially with regard to East, we see very much oriental accounts filled with stereotypes and prejudice against, you know, Indians and Chinese. So how does such contradicting accounts with an otherwise different and more popular narratives which were
Napoleon and Tipu, when Napoleon was living and when Tipu was living, it only shows that the British people had found an obstacle in Napoleon and in Tipu. It does not show that the British people loved him or liked them, but they were a very big factor in the British imagination at the time. You know, when Tipu was killed, I forget how, in London, they created a painting which was almost 100 yards long of the fall of Seringapatam, Seringapatam. And because they had painted Tipu in lurid colors, just as they painted Napoleon. I mention this only to show that at that time, the British people took Napoleon and Tipu very seriously. So today also, you know, we can think of some people in Asian world, African world, Chinese world, that the Europeans and Americans are impressed by. So that is a fact. So I'm not here to give any theory of how colonialists or Orientalists, how they portrayed the East. That is a very important question. But again, I would like to say, I wrote my book not to prove or disprove any theory, but to try to recreate the 17th century, 18th century, 19th century, 20th century. I belong to no school of historical philosophy, but I am humble, I make a humble effort to recreate the reality of that time to the best of my ability with as little partiality as possible. That is my attempt. That was my attempt in the story of Punjab, it is the attempt in my story of Southern India. Yes, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. How come we don't have any strong resistance from South Indian political leadership, especially? I get the question because, is it because we still have, we had powerful leaders like Kamraj, MPR, P.V. Narasimha Rao, not so much Devagoda, but yeah, he was. Is it because we had a very strong Nehru Gandhi dynasty? Powerful leaders like such as P.V. Narasimha Rao or Kamraj now, do you think they can resist better? That's the first question. Second question is about language, linguistic animosity among South Indians. You actually have shown us how was animosity was happening and it was not really unified in a sense. Even now, when you see, as far as I remember, it started with, you know, Linguistic Rearmation Act, you know, with Madras. Madras has been divided. What do you think? I know it's a kind of personal question, but what was Rajaji's stand on division? And the second thing is that, no, not just started, they started with that, you know, we had Periyar, Mulla Periyar Dam issue, we had Kaveri issue, we had Telangana issue. So it's not that, you know, it's not that rosy in a sense, you know, it's been there from 16th, 17th, and even 20th century. So I'd be happy if you can.
About the animosity that unfortunately does exist. You know, one conclusion I drew, or one finding I made in my all my historical research, as well as my observation of life in India, that we have opinions about others, we don't have knowledge about others. We have opinions about, so if I'm a Telugu speaker, I have opinions about Kannada, Tamil, Malayalam. Do I have enough knowledge? If I'm a Tamil speaker, I have opinions about Andhra. Do I have enough knowledge? Have I really studied enough? So this is a very important reality today. We must study enough and learn about our neighbors. You know, I've written this book so that North Indians may understand South India, but also so that South Indians may understand their South Indian neighbors. Telugu culture is very powerful, Tamil culture is very powerful, Kannada culture is very powerful, Malayali culture is very powerful, but let us also know our neighboring cultures, our neighboring history. And let us find also a way of solving our problems through dialogue and negotiation. You asked a very important question. It's a very difficult problem to tackle. But you guys, you will discover engineering solutions, but you must also discover human engineering solutions in the future. So I wish you all the best.
Thank you. Yeah, Kalidas.
In Southern India, for advancing sciences, engineering, mathematics, or linguistic inventions that happened between the period. Because there are some great temples that are built around time, eventually, they must be using good engineering technology for that.
You talked about ancient enterprises during this period. To be honest, that is not an area where I have focused much. There are many, many parts of South India's story that are not in this book. There is more work for other researchers and scholars. That's a very important question, but I have not much to contribute in that area.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Vinobaji plays some role. Anything is captured in your book. Vinobaji played a lot of role in unifying South India with North. Very during the freedom movement time, which was captured in
time? In 1969, when Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan visited India at Vinoba Bhave's invitation, Vinoba spoke, Jayaprakash Narayan spoke, Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan spoke. And then Vinoba also made this very interesting remark, 1969. He says, I always think of A, B, C. A for Afghanistan, B for Burma, C for Ceylon. And he felt India should have a very strong relationship with Afghanistan, with Burma, with Ceylon. So Vinoba did think in very large terms. Thank you. But just to return, Rajaji, somebody asked. Rajaji had the notion when Madras presidency was to be split into several. He had the notion, let us have a Dakshina Pradesh. Let us have a Dakshina Pradesh, but it was not an idea that was popular, did not gain much support, but he did mention that. So ideas like that were expressed from time to time.
Yeah, I think any more questions? Oh yeah.
So my question is, like, these days there are efforts by many communal elements to how can it affect our future generations, about the understanding about our history, and how can it affect our Indian society in general?
Polarization, that always happens. But we need not worry too much about that. Let us spread the facts as we know. Let us share the facts that we know to our neighbors, to our friends, one by one. I must tell you a story about 1940, when Gandhiji was alive and he had launched a movement, and Vinoba Bhave and Jawaharlal Nehru were arrested. And the British said to him, you cannot publish this news in your newspaper. So Gandhiji said, I will stop my newspapers for the time being. I'm a free man, I should be allowed to publish if these two have been arrested. If you don't allow me to publish this, I'll close my newspaper. Then he said, every reader should become a walking newspaper. A walking newspaper. And let each person spread the word truthfully. Only he or she should only convey what they know to be true, they should not convey false stories or rumors. But if after checking as to the best extent possible, you convey information, then no ban by any government can prevent the dissemination of facts and of news. This was much before social media was invented. And of course, today social media is full of fake news, of false news, of trolling. But if those of us who have collected some information can share the information clearly, lucidly, briefly, concisely, then we can depend on the good sense, common sense of the Indian people that truth shall triumph over falsehood.
Thank you.
Singh became more prominent than him. You know, instead of going into that, let us spread the news about Sitaram. Let us focus on the positive. If we know enough about him, let us share that news. Let us celebrate his extraordinary achievements. So instead of lamenting what does not happen, let us encourage the good things that can happen.
Thank you. By that, I think, you know, you can buy those books. Thank you very much, sir. Now I request our director to give a memento. I profusely thank Professor Rajmohan Gandhi to inaugurate the IIT Tirupati Distinguished Lecture Series. He inaugurated the series today, and we should have speakers like him in our future. I think if you have any other ideas who can be called for Distinguished Lecture Series, I request all of you to give the names. Then we will call them maybe every week also if it is possible. So I also thank Mrs. Rajmohan Gandhi to visit our campus, and then, so I think she would have got some positive opinion about this campus, what is going on. And of course, I also thank Professor Kapoor and his wife for coming and visiting our campus and then looking at our new things. Sir, we have only just started 3 or 4 years back, and then slowly we are crawling. Just to make this campus as quickly as possible to come up, that is one of the excellent tactics also, to have this campus as quickly as possible. Two IITs in 3 years, no IIT has achieved so much progress. I think we have to clap for him. International IITs who have started in 2008, still I think they are not moving to their own campus yet, some of them. So, but anyway, I think we are having a lot of progress because of his push in all. So I also thank all our staff and who worked under the directions of our Prof. Radhanarayana and also our registrar to have this place as it is looking now. Thank you very much for doing that, sir. And of course, engineering unit is the one which has really put a lot of effort to construct this. I think I was told that this is only in 2 days they have constructed this stage. And like that, if every building is done in 2 days, it will be excellent. I think really excellent, I think, if it is able to be completed. And of course, they muscle power into this kind of activity. Thanks. Thank you very much. And then I think we will take leave. Thank you very much.